mission. And should we win the day, the 4th of July will no longer be known as an American holiday, but as the day when the world declared in one voice, we will not go quietly into the night. We will not vanish without a fight.
Fall back!
Definitely bigger than the last one.
All right, well, good morning, Metro. Hey, just by show of hands, can I just see how many of you actually watched this movie at the theaters? Raise your hand. Okay, maybe about four or five of you. Okay, and good morning to those on our online community and to everyone in the nursery. I saw the movie as well a few weeks ago, and I gotta say, I think the trailer is actually better than the movie itself. But if you know anything about the franchise of Independence Day, the first one came out 20 years ago. Will Smith starred in it. It was a fantastic movie. And I think that's what propelled 20 years later to have this movie out. But in that first one, aliens come to invade the Earth, and Will Smith was one of the main characters. And through him and the other world army soldiers coming together, they defeated the aliens. And so as a result of it, they were able to obtain technology, different things, their weaponry, and they were able to learn from that and produce it themselves so that they can better prepare themselves for future alien invasions. Well, that's what the second movie was all about. Everyone thought that they were better prepared now to anticipate when the aliens would come, and they also felt that they were good enough to defend themselves better now because they had their technology. Well, when the aliens came, they were bigger, stronger, had more technology that they didn't have, and they invaded planet Earth. And as a result, their intention was to take away the freedom of humanity and to destroy the Earth. And so what we learn in this movie is we learn that freedom has a cost, that everyone in the movie had to give up something in order to obtain the freedom that they so desperately longed for. And we learn that freedom can be very, very costly. The heart of the gospel message, many of you know this, is that 2,000 years ago, God thought the world of all of us in this room, that he would send his son, Jesus Christ, to come and to die for us on the cross, resurrect from the dead. It's the heart of the gospel message. And many of us, we realize that because of that, we've been afforded freedom, that God has given to us freedom. And for many of us, we sort of interpreted that, and we sort of downloaded that to mean that we can do whatever we want in God's name, because God then, whatever we do, especially if we sin, God will forgive us for whatever we do. And though theologically you may be right, it's actually a very toxic way of thinking about it. How many of you in this room have children or you have nieces and nephews? Let me see your hands. Yeah, almost all of us, right? What would happen if you gave your niece and nephew, if you gave your children complete freedom? They'd probably die in less than a year, right? I mean, seriously, they don't want to go to sleep, they don't want to brush their teeth, they don't want to take a shower, they want to eat candy for breakfast. I mean, it just would be mayhem. It really would be. My kids, now that it's summer, I have to give them some structure for their day. Because if I don't give them structure and they just take the freedom that's given to them because it's summer break now, they don't have to go to school, they will watch TV and YouTube all day. They have the ability to do that. And they do it with high proficiency, all right? They won't open a book. I don't know why. My kids just are not readers. I wish. I mean, some of you, your kids, I mean, you can punish your kids by saying no reading. They'll be like, no, I want to read. My kids, if I say no reading, they think like, wow, what's happened? You're the best dad in the world. And so I have to force them to read every single day. I have to force them, create some level of structure, because freedom for them would actually cause them more harm than good. Many of you were like kids. And you've taken the gospel message at its heart and in its purest form. You've taken that freedom that God's given to you, and you feel like it's a license for you to do whatever you want. And it's tragic. And what we're going to learn today is that the freedom that God's given to us is very costly. It's costly for two reasons. Number one, it cost God his son to make you free so you and I can be free today. It cost God everything, so we can enjoy this freedom. And the second thing that we're reminded of, the freedom is costly for those who actually decide to want to live for God today. We're going to learn the costliness of freedom. And if we decide not to do it, if we decide not to step up and embrace the costliness of freedom, then many of us in this room will continue to live under the bondage of our hate. You will. Many of you are just angry all the time. Many of you will live under the bondage of your jealousy. You'll look at other people and what they have. You'll compare and you'll say, oh man, how come I don't have that? Many of you will live under the bondage of your insecurity. You're so insecure about yourself that if anyone were to say anything about you, you would often feel like those words would hurt so deep that maybe your life would be ruined. Some of you are so self-centered where everything revolves around you. Your world revolves around you. Nothing is for others, it's for you. Gossip, some of you love to gossip, you love to create division. Lust, the bondage of lust, the bondage of addictions like drugs and alcohol. And some of you have endured some serious deep wounds in your life. Well, even till this day, you still lick those wounds as if they're still fresh because they've never healed. They've never healed in your life. As a result, you have no joy. We have no joy. You have no one in your life that you feel really loves you and cares for you. And so you live your life as if you're a prisoner to your own brokenness. And that's why you can't live in healthy relationships. That's why you can't have healthy relationships with your spouse, your children, your family members, friends, maybe in this church, outside of this church, because in your eyes, it's always their fault. In your eyes, it's always their issue that they're trying to destroy and hurt this relationship, right? Everyone is out to get you, and you feel like you have to fight them, otherwise you're going to get hurt again. And so you fight, and you fight, and you fight, and you're not living in freedom. You're living in bondage to your insecurities and to your anger and your insecurities. Some of you have such a low sense of who you are that you actually allow anyone or everyone to basically run all over you. You're definitely afraid that they will reject you if you actually shared a thought that came from your heart or your mind. And so as a result of it, you become a yes man or a yes woman, and you say yes to everything, and what's happening is you're dying a slow death because you're pretending to be somebody that you're not, because you're longing for the acceptance of someone else, and that's not how God's wired you. And as a result of it, you just will say yes to everyone and anyone, and in many ways, you're dying a slow death because of it, because you're living the life of an imposter, in the words of Brennan Manning. For some of you in this room, you're on autopilot. You are a doer. You've been doing. You've been a doer for decades. You've never processed things that you're dealing with, even on an emotional level, because maybe as a child, you went through some hardships, and what became a survival mechanism of you shutting down emotionally to survive, today is actually hijacking and destroying all the important relationships in your life today. And God forbid if somebody would actually sit down and start to talk to you. You're definitely afraid of the reality. If somebody might sit down and ask you how you're really doing, what you're going through. And so as a result of it, what do? You create small talk. You talk about the Knicks acquiring Rose, and you talk about them acquiring Joakim Noah. You talk about sports, pop culture, and different things like that. Because the thought of you engaging in a real conversation is terrifying. It's terrifying for you because you're a prisoner and you don't know how to live in freedom. My hope today is that we're going to learn the costliness of this freedom. But I hope that all of you, like the folks did in this movie, will sign up and say, you know what, I'm going to be free. No matter how much it costs me, I'm going to live in freedom today. How do we begin to do that? How do you begin to live in true freedom today? Well, there's some great insight to this in Galatians chapter 5. And so if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Galatians chapter 5. We're going to look at verses 13 through 26. Galatians 5, verse 13 to 26. It'll be up on the screen, or you can even download it. You can check it out on your Metro app. It says, you, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command. Love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit is what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions and factions and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with his passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking, and envying each other. This is the word of God. Let's pray. Lord, this is a heavy text, and this is really a heavy topic. I pray for those in this room, God, who feel like they're in bondage, for those who feel like they just can't be free, for those who go to these business meetings and go to parties for business or for social things, and they just feel like they can't really be themselves because they are convinced that if people were to truly see who they are, that they may not like them. I pray, God, for those who are struggling today, who often believe that the sins that they struggle with is greater than you, or the problems that they may be enduring today is greater than you. Lord, would you deliver us, and would you set us free? And so, God, I pray that the words that come out of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts in this room today, I pray, God, that it would be pleasing unto you. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Let me just give you a little background as to why Paul was writing this letter to the church of Galatia. What was happening during this time was that Paul had started the church there. And he left because Paul's a tent maker. He goes from city to city and starts different churches. And so as a result of that, he left quite soon. And so as a result, a lot of the Christians in Galatia didn't fully know how to live their life for God. And what was happening was that there was a group of Christians called the Judaizers. Now, the Judaizers are Christians who believe in Jesus Christ, but they also believe in the Mosaic laws. They believe in the teachings of Moses so much so that they believe that Moses' teaching was just as important as the teachings of Jesus. And so what they did was that they capitalized on sort of the place where these Christians were in Galatia. They said to them, they said, because you don't fully know how to live your life, because you don't know what God you are to follow, and a lot of them were struggling, they really want to know, how do we live our lives in a way where God will accept us, where God is pleased with our lives? Right? When you look at their ancestry and the Jewish faith, there were rules to follow through. And so the Judaizers just embraced the Mosaic laws and said, you got to live the life in which Moses has encouraged us to live. And part of that was that they encouraged the Christians there, the men, to get circumcised, because circumcision was an outward sign that God has accepted you fully. You need to get circumcised. And so they're saying, if Paul was here, and if he was here longer, he would have taught you the full gospel, not just Jesus, but he would have taught you Moses' as well in the Mosaic laws. So he says, therefore, you all need to be circumcised. And this is why Paul writes this letter, and he says, no, you don't. You cannot do this. And what was Paul doing here? Because when you read this letter and you read the entire book of Galatians, you'll find that Paul actually kind of looked like he was against the Mosaic laws. He really wasn't against the Mosaic laws, but what was happening with the Judaizers and their influencing of the community there was that he was teaching them something that was negating the power of what Christ has done for us on the cross. Every religion that you and I know of in this world, every religion in this world, continued to teach us that in order for you to be accepted by God, you have to obey. And that's what these Galatians wanted to know. They said, hey, how do we live life so that God could accept us? And Paul was saying, it's not about what you do. It's not about you getting circumcised that will experience the acceptance of God. No, you have been accepted because Jesus Christ has died for you and resurrected from the dead. The heart of the gospel message. You see, the Christian faith, unlike any other faith that's out there, says that God's already accepted you because of what Christ has done for you on the cross. And because of that, you've been accepted by God. Therefore, through that acceptance, you obey. That's the power of the Christian message. Amen? And so Paul was so against this at this time because what they were doing was that the Christians here were believing in this and they were causing tremendous division because they too believed that in order for us to be accepted by God, we have to get circumcised. And Paul is saying, no. Christ came and died for you. Resurrected from the dead. Why do you feel like you need to do something to be accepted? A lot of you struggle with that too. A lot of you, because of the culture of the church and the history that you have in the church today, you still believe that you have to do certain things to feel accepted by God. And so I hope you understand and identify with the community here and what Paul is trying to say. And Paul is saying that you have been given a freedom that God has given to you. And he's saying the freedom is costly. Why is it costly? Because Jesus Christ had to come and die for us on the cross and resurrect from the dead. But the second part of why it's costly is because it requires you and I, if you want to live in that freedom, to live under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. That's costly, guys. It's very costly for you to live your life in such a way where you can be guided by the Holy Spirit. It costs a lot. True freedom in Christ, as Paul says, is when you and I live our life daily under the guidance and leadership of the Holy Spirit. I would dare say that the majority of us in this room have no idea what that's even like. You've never dived in and touched and experienced the Holy Spirit guiding you and leading you in your life. The Holy Spirit is the third person in the Godhead. Jesus says that in the Gospel of John, that the Holy Spirit will be your counselor. He will be your guide. He will lead you and lead your life in ways that you won't be able to do alone. Jesus even goes as far as to say you'll do greater things than he will because you'll have the counselor, the Holy Spirit, with you. And it's your job and my job to live our life in such a way so that we can live under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. You ever meet someone where they start talking about the Holy Spirit like it's their friend? And you're like, oh man, what's wrong with you? Like, it just kind of seems weird, right? I had dinner with this one couple, and this one woman said, well, you know, I got all ready, I got this job, and I said I was going to go, I got my cab, I was going to go, and we're going to fly out and move to this different country for this job. And then God, the Holy Spirit said, no, get out of the car, go back home, you're not to take this job. And she started sharing this with me, and I started thinking, wow, you're kind of weird. Like, you said yes to this job, and all of a sudden the Holy Spirit said no, and you decided not to, and you didn't. And then, of course, she explained the story, and it was fascinating as you hear the story because God had something else for her, and God was leading her in a certain way, and it was just such a beautiful way in how she surrendered herself to the guidance and to the leadership of the Holy Spirit. And I remember just at that moment, I said, yeah, I need to live my life more like that as well. I need to live my life with such freedom in God that as the Holy Spirit guides and directs me, that there will be the sense of freedom that I have so that I can live my life the way he wants me to. All of you long that, you do. But you know what? It's not easy. It's not easy to listen to the Holy Spirit because many of you in this room, you don't like taking orders from people. How many of you like taking orders? I mean, I got into a fight with my wife during Father's Day because she kept ordering me around. She goes, hey, you know, go get the laundry. And I said, well, you know what? It's Father's Day. I'm not going to do that today. If there's any day I don't have to listen to you, it's today. Father's Day, right? My daughter gets tennis lessons. She goes, can you go please pick up Christina? I said, you know, I actually would like to do that, but today's Father's Day, so I'm not going to do that. Husbands, I don't recommend you do that with your spouse because at nighttime, we got into a real big fight because of that. I use my Father's Day card. But what that teaches me is this. I don't like taking orders from anyone. I like doing what I want to do. I guarantee you every single one of you is the same way. The reason why this is so costly is because you don't really want to live under the guidance of the Holy Spirit because you don't like to take orders. You want to do what you want to do. And that's why when you take God's freedom and you think about his freedom, you take it as a license for you to do whatever you want to do. But rather, that freedom is for you to be in a relationship with the Holy Spirit because, yes, Jesus Christ came and died for us on the cross and resurrected from the dead. So now we have a potential to have this relationship with God. Here's God, here's us. But how do we get connected to God? The Holy Spirit. That's the only way. That's what brings us to him, but it has a cost. How do you live your life daily? Because I'm telling you, if you guys can get this today, like Paul got it, your life will be blessed. You'll be able to live your life in such a way where you'll be able to hear from the Lord through scripture, through you just living life. About a year and a half ago, I went to LA with my kids and my wife. Before I went out, it was right after Easter, it was during their spring break. My mother was kind of sick. She came to church, our church, for that day, and she looked a bit sick, but I just thought it was just a phase. So we went to LA, got there, checked in on her every day. She went to the doctors on Monday because she wasn't feeling good, and she took urine samples. She did everything. The doctor says she was fine according to what he saw. Wednesday morning, I kid you not, the Holy Spirit woke me up and said, your mom needs to go to the emergency room. And it was one of those, it doesn't happen all the time, but it happened. And so I knew that in order to get my mom to the emergency room, somebody had to come and take her because she would never go on her own. She doesn't like hospitals. And so I called my sister-in-law, Michelle, and I said, would you please go to my mom's house and wait for her downstairs? I'm going to tell her to come down. And long story short, she did, and she went to the hospital. She went to the ER, and later we discovered that she had a blood infection, which started out as a urinary tract infection. And the doctor said, had she waited another day, she could have died. She stayed in the hospital for 7 days almost. That's how infected her blood was. How do you live life in a way where the Holy Spirit can speak and share things with you and lead you and guide you in ways? I think all of you desire that. You long it. What does Paul say? How do we do this? All right, there's a couple things here, and they're all costly. Two from this passage, and then third one we get from Henry Nouwen, all right, that I had to mention, I had to include here today. The first thing that you and I have to do so that we can live by the power of the Holy Spirit, so that we can experience this freedom that is costly, is that we have to learn to crucify the flesh. Turn to your neighbor and just say, crucify your flesh. Come on. Crucify your flesh. Because that's what Paul says in verse 24. Look what he says. He says, those who belong to Christ Jesus, just those who belong to Christ Jesus, have crucified the flesh with his passions and desires. All right, listen, you and I have to intentionally, on a daily basis, crucify our flesh. If we don't do that, because for Paul, the flesh is synonymous to your sinful nature. Anything your flesh desires and craves, anything that has passion and cravings from it, is sinful according to Paul, your fleshly desires. And the Spirit, those who live in the Spirit, always are living opposite or contrarian to their fleshly desires. And if you want to live under the freedom of the Holy Spirit, you and I have to be conscious enough where on a daily basis we are dying to our flesh. We are crucifying our flesh in that way. And so what do we need to be mindful of? In verses 19 to 21, let's just go there. Paul sort of divides the works of the flesh in four areas, all right? The first area that he divides the works of the flesh, the first thing is sexual sins. He talks about sexual morality, he talks about impurity, and he talks about debauchery. What are those things? Sexual morality is when you're married and you're having sex with someone else other than your spouse. That's sexual morality. Sexual morality is that if you're single today and you're having sex or casual sex, that's sexual immorality. Impurity, debauchery, or anything where it could be addictions with pornography, masturbation, things like that. Those are fleshly desires that only lead to greater division where you are living under the influence and power of the enemy and your fleshly desires and not living under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Sexual sins. The second category he categorizes is the religious sins that you and I commit. The first religious sin is idolatry. All of you have idols in your life. Idol is basically whatever in your life is more important than God. And we all struggle with that. Your idol could be your child. Your idol could be you wanting to have a child. Your idol could be you getting married. Your idol could be God healing your marriage. Your idol could be something as frivolous as a computer or a phone, things like that. Your idol could be success. Your idol could be a promotion, whatever it might be. Whatever is more important to you than God, that is your idol. We all struggle with that. We got to crucify that on a daily basis. The other thing is witchcraft. Witchcraft. Now, I don't think all of us struggles with witchcraft, but there's some of you in this room where you have dabbled into the evil spirits, where you've touched and connected with the evil one intimately. And there has to be sort of a purification and a crucifying that you need to go through to be cleansed from that. Social sins, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy. All of these social sins we all struggle with. That's why we live such divided lives today. We all struggle with anger. We all struggle with discord. We all struggle with jealousy and envy and fits of rage, with selfishness. We struggle with that. You got to crucify your flesh of that daily. And then the last one, and the best way for me to describe it, is substance sins, like alcohol, drunkenness, and orgies. All of these destroy unity. All of these breaks your relationship with God. All of these lead to bondage for you living with the desires of your flesh. Paul is saying we have to be conscious enough to get up daily and to crucify ourselves to our fleshly desires, because if we don't, he says this, not me, he says you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. That's pretty strong teaching here. Jesus says if anyone would follow after him, he says, let him deny himself and pick up his cross and follow me. That's Jesus' way of saying you have to die and crucify your fleshly desires. It's a life that you will live of rejection, of self-denial in your life. In the movie Independence Day, we find that in this movie that the people knew that these aliens were aliens. And they knew they had to destroy them, that they couldn't be friends with them. Right? The queen, alien, she was the one that they had to get at. They realized they couldn't just talk to the queen and try to negotiate and be friends. They knew that in order for them to survive and experience freedom, they had to crucify, they had to destroy all of the aliens, including the queen. Many of you, when you look at your sinful nature or your fleshly desires, you don't see it as alien to you. It becomes your friend. And that's dangerous. It really is. You have to see your fleshly desires, those passions, those four things that Paul is talking about, the sexual sins, the religious sins, the social sins, the substance sins. You have to see that's alien. You have to treat it like that, because if you don't, then it'll just become a friend of yours, a partner in life, a partner in crime in your life. So how do we crucify our flesh? How do we crucify our flesh? I love it. It's one word, repentance. Repentance is how you and I crucify our flesh. So here's how we do it. Repentance isn't just you saying, God, forgive me of my sins. But repentance in its theological word is you actually turning the opposite direction of your sin. Is you actually turning away from your sin and walking the other direction. That is what repentance is about. And if you and I want to crucify our flesh, it's about repentance. So I love the word repentance because it presupposes that we will sin in one of these four categories. Sexual sins, religious sin, social sins, substance sins. Those would be things that we will struggle with at some levels in our life all the time. But repentance is about you turning the other way and saying, nah, God, don't just forgive me, but I am actually going to do my best now to walk the other direction and not live according to those desires anymore in my life. Amen? And what's the best way to do it? Confess it in the presence of someone else. That's true repentance. I probably share that once a month, but I would say probably 95% of you still, you don't confess your sins to somebody. When was the last time you sat down and you actually confessed your sins to someone? Do you know why you're always being controlled by your fleshly desires? You see, that's cost a lot, doesn't it? It's costly. Freedom costs a lot if you have to actually sit down with somebody and confess all of your sins. And if you're not doing that, you're not really repenting. Because Dietrich Bonhoeffer says, if you're not confessing your sins in the presence of someone else, you're probably just confessing it to yourself because you certainly ain't confessing it to God. Because Jesus says, when two or more are gathered in my name, I will be there. You want God to fully forgive you of your sins? Jesus says, when two or more are gathered, I will be there. My recommendation for all of you is that at least once or twice a month, minimally, you need to be sitting down with someone, confessing your sins with that person. If you don't, you really give the enemy a lot of authority in your life. I have a friend I ministered side by side with for a few years, and I've known for quite a while. We're not very close, but years ago I heard that he had a moral failing, meaning he cheated on his wife. He was a pastor. And he fell hard. Church, of course, let him go. And about 2 years ago, we got together and I just met with him and we chatted. And he was very open about what happened, which I was really thankful because I didn't really know him that well. But he said the greatest downfall to him was that he never confessed his sins to anyone. Because he was becoming a high-profile pastor in church, he planted a church, was doing really well. That nobody kept him in check. And in his words, he said he needed somebody in his life where he can be ruthlessly honest with, and he needed somebody to be ruthlessly honest about him. And he said because he didn't have that in his life, he fell and unfortunately did something that he regretted, and he continues to experience the hardships of that today because he's still not in ministry as a result of it. Listen, if it can happen to a pastor, it can happen to anyone. If you want to crucify your flesh today, confess your sins to someone at least once or twice a month. That's costly, isn't it? Nobody in this room enjoys. I mean, anyone enjoy doing that? I do, and I hate it even till this day because I guarantee you, the next time you think about doing that sin again, you're going to think about, oh, man, but I got to share it with this person if I do it. And there's a deeper sense of accountability there. It's not just you going to God and saying, forgive me of the sin again. If you really want God to be present in this repentance, you confess it in the presence of someone else. And I guarantee you just have that victory over those fleshly desires that Paul is talking about. Because you know that if you commit it again, you're going to have to share it with this person. And please, when you're in this encounter, when you're talking to this person and confessing your sins, it's very important if you're the listener to say, in Jesus' name, your sins are forgiven. Right? And then if you're the one confessing, then it's important that the listener says, okay, in Jesus' name, your sins are forgiven. It's important to say that. All right? In my relationships, I always say, in Jesus' name, your sins are forgiven. I'm not forgiving you of your sins, but Jesus is here. And because you confess that he's forgiven you, right? That's an important aspect to it. That costs a lot, I think. But if you want to crucify your flesh today, it's the only way you're going to do it. Start doing it. Give yourself 1 year. I guarantee you, speak to me before you do it, and then let's meet a year after. You'll have freedom. Freedom from sexual sins, religious sins, social sins, and substance sins. Once you start doing that, then you can do the second thing in order for you to live under the guidance of the Holy Spirit so that you can experience this freedom of Christ is to you become a unifier, not a divider. All right. Once you've been able to crucify your flesh, then you start to live your life where you actually care about bringing unity to things and relationships rather than dividing. All right, look at verse 13. Verse 13. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command, love your neighbor as yourself. Jump over to verse 22. Paul says, but the fruit of the Spirit is what? It's love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. A unifier is somebody who brings people together rather than dividing. Listen, just ask yourself, are you a unifier or are you a divider? In your relationships, are there a lot of drama in your relationships? You might be a divider, if there are. And it might not just be that other person that's causing that division. It's probably you as well, right? Are you known for bringing people together, working for reconciliation and unity? That's the power of the gospel. Or do you divide a lot? So I find that people who actually hurt people and divide a lot are actually the ones who are the most afraid. Because they don't want to get hurt, they'd rather do the hurting first before they get hurt, and they just create divisions all along. The people who bring unity rather than division are often those who are living under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. And all the fruits of the Spirit, if you look at it, impacts your social relationships. It's all to bring greater unity in the relationships that you have. So how do you become a unifier? How do you do that? How do you and I become a unifier? It's really what Paul says in verse 14. It's to love your neighbor as yourself. I've talked about this, all right? But in order for you to love your neighbor, you have to first learn to love yourself. That's key. Many of you, I would think, you're not loving yourself in a healthy way. You're just not. We struggle with loving ourselves. Now, some of you are loving yourself in an unhealthy way where everything, again, revolves around you. That is not what God's talking about here. That's not the kind of love that he wants you to have, because that kind of love creates division. When everything is always about you being right all the time, then that causes division. That's not what God is after. He's after you loving yourself in such a healthy way that you know you are his beloved in whom he's well pleased with. That's it. God wants you to live your life in such a way where every day you know you're God's beloved in whom he's well pleased with. Because if you don't live your life that way, if you don't live your life knowing that you're God's beloved, then you're going to expect somebody in your community to love you that way. And they can't. Nobody can love you the way God loves you. Your spouse can't do that. Your kids can't do that. Your friends can't do that. Nobody can love you like that. When you live your life outside of knowing that you are God's beloved, you're going to expect somebody else in your community to love you that way. And that's why you divide. Because you're going to be disappointed, I guarantee you. Nobody's perfect. Only one that is, and that's God. And you have to center yourself in a way where you know you're God's beloved in whom he's well pleased with it. But that costs a lot. That's not easy, because you know that here. But many of you don't know it here, because you're still living like an orphan. You're still living like a slave today. How do you get it here? You know how you get it here? I mean, I've tried other ways. There's only one way I know it to be true. Solitude. silence and solitude. I love reading the Gospels because you'll find Jesus doing miraculous things. He's doing great ministry. And then it says he often went away alone and he prayed all day, all night. He was alone just with God. Listen, you need to create some space in your life where it's just you and God. And in the midst of that, it's not about what you do, but you just being alone with God and you know that he is your, that you are his beloved. Man, that's freeing. That releases you from a lot of things. But the only way you can do that is you got to start slowing down your life. You have to start creating opportunities in your day, at least twice a day, where you're having some level of silence and solitude in your life. And nobody in this room likes being alone and likes being quiet. Nobody in this room enjoys that, especially in the culture we live in today. The only ones who actually do are the ones who've actually experienced the belovedness of God's love because they've actually experienced that kind of solitude in their life. But if you continue to run away from silence and solitude and you continue to go after the fast food spirituality stuff, you're never going to know you're God's beloved. And as a result of that, because you don't, you expect other people in your community to treat you that way. And you become a divider, not a unifier. And so will you center yourself? One of the best things to do is, we talked about this with Pete Scazzaro a few months ago on Emotional Healthy Spirituality. Get his Day by Day or the Daily Office book. Can you give God 8 minutes of silence in your day? 4 minutes in the morning, maybe 4 minutes in the afternoon or at night. Get a little scripture and just meditate, knowing that you're God's beloved and whom he's well pleased with. If you don't do that, then I guarantee you, you will expect other people in your life to love you that way, and they just can't do that. They'll fail miserably, and it'll hurt. People who are able to know that they're God's beloved are able to be unifiers, and the unifiers are the history makers in this world. People who can bring people together. They can do tremendous things for God because they're unifiers, they're not dividers. So in this movie, Independence Day, one of the, sort of like the last scene, the two main characters in this movie are two people, Liam Hemsworth, who played Jake Morrison, and Jesse Usher, who played Dylan Hiller. These are two very good-looking guys. And they hated each other in the beginning because they were both probably the best pilots America had to offer. But Jake was kind of a crazy guy. And so they went on this sort of this test flying drill. And he was so reckless and crazy because he loved taking risks and chances. Dylan almost died. And Dylan is the son of Will Smith's character 20 years ago. Who was it? Stephen Hiller. Right? Stephen Hiller. And so because Dylan almost died, they got into a huge fight and they no longer were friends anymore. Even during the movie, they even got into a fist combat altercation because Dylan, again, was so upset how selfish Jake was. Well, when the aliens came and when the queen was pushing forth her dominance, they finally were able to come together rather than being divided apart. And as they came together, they were, spoiler alert, you guys know what happens. They were able to defeat the queen because of that. Right? Because they unified. A good testament to know that the Spirit's working in you is that you're actually a unifier, not a divider. Where are you in that? Are you a unifier or are you a divider? You need to know that you are God's beloved. Because if you don't know that, you're going to expect everyone in your community to love you that way. And that's why your life is so screwed up. Because they can't offer that for you. Only God can offer that to you. The very last thing in how you live under the influence of the Holy Spirit so that you can experience this freedom that God offers you, which is costly, is you got to learn to be grateful. You and I have to learn to be grateful. Turn with me to 1 Thessalonians verse 5. We're going to look at 18. This is what Paul says. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. What's part of you? What God's will for you is, you got to learn to give thanks more. You have to learn to be more grateful because gratefulness at the end of the day is a choice you make. It's not based upon your circumstances. That's why Paul says, be thankful in all circumstances. Now, for some of you who are things are going well, I would say that's probably easy for you to be grateful, but that's not the challenge here. The reason why freedom is so costly is because you're challenged to be grateful even in the midst of difficult circumstances that you might be going through today. That's the challenge. Can you be grateful even though you're struggling today? Can you be grateful even though I know some of you here are struggling with infertility? Can you be grateful even in the midst of that? Can you be grateful even though you may be single today and you've wanted to be married? When you were a girl or boy growing up, you hope to be married by now. You hope to have a few kids, but you're still single. Can you still learn to be grateful in the midst of that? Can you learn to be grateful even though your marriage is horrible and maybe it may never be good? Can you still be grateful because of that? Can you still be grateful that maybe you're struggling today financially, maybe you're unemployed? Can you still be grateful in the midst of that? Can you be grateful? The reason why this is so key, Henry Nouwen says, he's a very famous author. I encourage you guys to read anything that he writes. But he says the reason why gratefulness is so key is because when somebody has a grateful heart, it allows the Holy Spirit to heal their wounds in life. The reason why you're so bitter and angry and you're saying, God, heal me. You know how God heals you? He heals you when you're grateful for even the hurts and the pains in your life today. And I know it's a process. It doesn't happen overnight. But my hope and my prayer for you today is that you would learn to be grateful in all circumstances, because if you're not, you're going to live a life of bitterness and you're going to live a life of greed, which is the opposite of gratefulness today. Some of you have been through some hard stuff. I've been through some hard stuff as well. I grew up in a home where my father struggled with alcohol, and he'd come home and he would often take out his frustrations physically on myself, my sisters, especially my mother. Living with that kind of fear as a child growing up, and perhaps if I heard this sermon maybe 30 years ago, I might be very upset right now. And maybe some of you are, because you're thinking, how dare you say I got to be grateful for what I just went through in my life. I stand here today, I am so grateful for what I've gone through. Because if I didn't go through that, I wouldn't know the depth of God's love for me, and I certainly would not be able to be your pastor. You see, the gospel at its heart is that resurrection can't happen unless there's a death. Sometimes as you and I go through deathly situations, that's when we experience the hand of God in a beautiful way, what Jesus says in 2 Corinthians, my strength is perfected in your weaknesses. I've noticed over the years, and as I've traveled the world, that those who have much are the least grateful people. And you know who has much? Is Americans. As I travel the world, as I go to South Africa on a yearly basis, I'll meet people who don't even have a change of clothes. I meet people who don't even have shoes, and they have holes in their clothing, and they're dirty, and they're living in abject poverty, but they're so grateful. It blows me away every year as I go and I see that. Thinking, how could I not be grateful? I should be more grateful than them. But it's amazing. It's weird that the less you have, the higher propensity you have to be more grateful today. Years ago, I took a group from our church to South Africa. And, you know, I go every year. So for me, it was just another year in a 16-hour plane ride, which I was not looking forward to. But the group that I took, I mean, there were a bunch of extroverts in that group. And when we got into the plane, I mean, they were excited. You could feel the energy. They were loud. And I thought perhaps maybe after a few hours, you know, the energy would die down. But over 10 hours into the trip, they were louder than ever. And the flight attendant came over and said, shut up. People are complaining. They cannot sleep because you're too loud. So they had to shut it down. They were so grateful that they had this opportunity to go to another part of the world and see what God might be doing. A good friend of mine once said, a wealthy guy, he said to me, he said, if you want to see sad people on a flight, just go to business or first class. Nobody's happy there. Nobody's happy. He said it's the atmosphere, because he flies business first class all the time. He said it's like a funeral. The atmosphere is a funeral. So he says that what he has to do before the flight takes off, he walks over to coach, and he just surrounds himself with the joy of people just so happy and thankful that they can afford a plane ticket to go to another part of the world and experience the beauty of what that culture and that country might have to offer them. They're so grateful, he says, compared to these people in business class. And some of you in this room, you're living your life as if you're in business class and first class. Yes, Jesus Christ came and died for you. Yes, he's done that. Yes, you have a first class ticket. But why aren't you thankful about it? Why? Why do you live your life like a spoiled saint? And you're not grateful for the beauty that is your life today. And somebody in Africa who has nothing could be 10 times more thankful than you and me. Do you know why you're not living in the freedom of the Spirit today? Because you don't know how to be thankful for what you already have. And Paul is simply saying that if you want to live in freedom today, it does come at a cost. You got to crucify your flesh and ask people to confess your sins in front of them. You have to do that. You have to know that you are the beloved. But that's going to require you to slow down your life. Maybe you might have to change careers because of that. Maybe you might have to disappoint your parents because they continue to control your life today. But you're going to have to say, no more. Because I need to know that I'm God's beloved. And you're going to have to learn to be grateful, even though you might be going through hardships today. Because if you can't do that, then you're going to be sucked into this life of hate, anger, discord, jealousy, lust, whatever the devil wants to do to destroy your life today. So you have a choice today. Will you rise up and fight? Will you fight for the freedom that you have in Jesus Christ today? Let's pray.